From the nation's capital, this is the Fly Fishing Consultant Podcast with your host, Rob Snowett.
You are listening to the Fly Fishing Consultant Podcast. This is Series 2, Episode 67. I interviewed Joseph of Save Our Wild Salmon. We're going to learn about salmonid and orca conservation in the Pacific Northwest and what you can do as listeners and donors to help his nonprofit bring down the dams and restore wild fish in the Pacific Northwest. Please visit his website, wildsalmon.org. For more information. This is your time to shine.
Great. All right, thanks, Rob, for hosting this. Yeah.
All right. So I met you. Well, do you want to introduce yourself first?
Sure.
Let's introduce you.
Okay. Should I do that?
Go for it.
Okay. Hi. My name is Joseph Bogaard. I'm the executive director of the Save Our Wild Salmon Coalition, which is an alliance of conservation groups, commercial and recreational fishing groups, clean energy advocates, orca advocates, a lot of different constituencies working together, concentrated in the Pacific Northwest, but with support from around the country, working on restoration of what was once one of our most productive salmon landscapes on the planet, the Columbia-Snake River Basin.
All right. And let's find out, where are you today?
I'm based in Seattle.
Okay. And remind me, we met in line at the Yeti booth years ago at ICAST in Vegas.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Man, that was a long time ago.
It was a long time ago, Rob.
I still use that cup. That's my teacup. Switching awesome. Tea out of mostly. Yeah. All right. So you're in Seattle. Tell us about your background. Where did you grow up? Were you into fish and conservation, or did that come later in life?
No, I grew up in Southern California, just outside of Los Angeles. And, you know, it wasn't necessarily the best fit for me as I was growing up, although I didn't quite realize that at the time, because it's hard to have that kind of perspective when you're young. But I think my nickname amongst my friends was Johnny Appleseed, which was some reference to the fact that I had tendencies towards conservation and being outside and hiking and being in the mountains. When I finished high school, I headed to Northern California, went to college there, studied zoology and environmental studies, and then spent most of my 20s working and exploring the West, the Western United States, which is a landscape I've really come to love. And I sort of steadily worked my way up into Oregon and then into Seattle, where I've been since 1991. And, in college, I definitely had sort of orientation towards, biology, zoology, conservation issues. Those sort of interests have only gotten stronger. And I've been working for the Save Our Wild Salmon Coalition for over 20 years.
Wow.
And the first listings under the Endangered Species Act of salmon anywhere in the country were Snake River sockeye back in 1991. And when that occurred, that set off, a red flag and alarms about where Pacific Northwest salmon were headed. And also, I think, opportunity for people to organize and turn the tide and begin to work on restoring not just the sockeye, but other salmon and steelhead populations in the basin that soon followed the sockeye onto the Endangered Species Act as threatened or endangered.
Right. What is the mission statement of SOS? Should we just go SOS for abbreviation? I'm not calling for help.
Sure.
That's your organization.
So our acronym is SOS, and our mission statement is to protect and restore the wild salmon and steelhead populations in the Columbia-Snake River Basin to healthy, self-sustaining, harvestable levels for the benefit of natural systems, fish and wildlife, including orca, and human communities, tribal and non-tribal communities in the Pacific Northwest that highly value for various reasons salmon and steelhead populations.
All right, so that's your mission statement. One other question. I'm going to basically break down SOS and what they do and how they operate. For your operating budget, is it donations, fundraising? Do you seek grants? And if you do, who do you seek them from?
So Save Our Wild Salmon, we have a budget of about $250,000 annually. So we're, in the big scheme of things, a fairly small, lean organization. A lot of our strength and power and influence and impact comes from the fact that we are this large, diverse coalition of interests that are all working in a similar direction to address the problem salmon face in the Columbia Snake system. And SOS's role is to largely to help develop that strategy and then coordinate with our partners so that their various skills, talents, contacts, and so forth can be brought to bear to benefit these populations, our rivers, communities that rely on them. So the sources of our funding are varied. Foundations, large major donors, small grassroots donors. We also get a not insignificant amount of money from various businesses that recognize that agree with our mission, that recognize the value that salmon represent to the Columbia, to the Pacific Northwest and nation. Whether it's cultural, economic, environmental, so forth. The fundraising is a primary responsibility of mine. It's obviously sort of important work. It never ends. And we are, deeply appreciative of the support we get from sort of various supporters at whatever level they're able to do so.
And what are your fundraising events like? Out here, it's cocktail parties, black ties, $1,000 plate. We were just watching, showing my daughter Dumb and Dumber, and the whole owl scene was $500 a plate, and they just stuffed the guy's pocket with $1,000 of money. But that was Colorado. How do you do it out in Seattle?
Well,
Microsoft to show up at all?
It's a good question. Our operations are more based on, I think, individual contacts, foundation grant applications, that sort of thing. We do host a lot of events, but they're often done in concert with our partners, and they're not those sorts of sort of high-end, expensive events that raise a bunch of money. That's just not been a strategy we've deployed, for better or for worse. Again, we're a pretty small operation, and all of our sort of resources and activities we're pretty thoughtful about. So it varies. We do a lot of online fundraising. I meet with anyone who's interested in learning more about what we're doing, and I'm sort of always ready and willing to ask them for their support and find out sort of how they want to get involved and support our activities. So we do periodically hold, fundraising events, but they're not along the lines you just described, Rob. We do a lot of our events are focused on education of the public, of elected officials, of media, of opinion leaders and influencers. And we do it, you know, largely around the Pacific Northwest in, you know, Oregon, Washington, Idaho. And if we're not leading events, then we're often, you know, supporting our partners' events to achieve the same sorts of outcomes.
Who are some of the organizations you have alliances with, other organizations, nonprofits?
Sure. So SOS is a coalition with, you know, something over 40 organizations. And we probably have maybe 15 or 18 that are particularly engaged and active, and they include, you know, groups like Natural Resources Defense Council, Defenders of Wildlife, the Sierra Club, Earth Justice, big national groups, and we've also got, you know, state and regionally based organizations like the Northwest Sport Fishing Industry Association and the Coastal Trawlers Association and Pacific Coast Federation of Fishermen's Associations, Idaho Rivers United, NIMIPU, Protecting the Environment, is an organization that was created and is led by Nez Perce tribal members based in southeast Washington and Idaho, traditional Nez Perce country. And homelands. So we work, you know, while tribal people are not, tribes are not members of our coalition, given their sovereign nations, it wouldn't be appropriate. We do work frequently and closely with a lot of the tribal people in the Pacific Northwest. I was just going to add one other sort of class of groups that we work with. Is sort of orca advocates, and that's an issue at some point we'd love to talk more about, but it's emerged particularly in the last 3-4 years as the scientific information about the connection between southern resident orcas and Columbia Basin salmon has become much clearer. Both salmon in the Columbia Basin are listed on the ESA, and southern resident killer whales are as well, and the killer whales rely on salmon for their Chinook salmon for their primary food source. And so there's this strong nexus between the two critters, and we've got to figure out ways forward that are going to protect and restore both populations, which are really in different ways very iconic Pacific Northwest creatures, species, communities that we would be much lesser for it if we were allow either of them to disappear.
Why are they specifically feeding on the Chinooks? Is it their size? Is it they're at the same location at the same time with migrations and spawning, mating?
Yep. So the orca, of course, spend their entire life in marine water, salt water. Their range takes them over the course of any given year from southern British Columbian coastal waters down as far as northern California. And they've been around here for at least hundreds of thousands of years. And there's a number of different unique orca populations in the off the coast of the United States and around the world. And the southern resident orcas is one subpopulation. And over time, they have come to specialize on Chinook salmon. About 80% of their diet is based on Chinook salmon today. And of course, that population, as those populations have declined, that's had a obviously harmful effect on the mortality of this population and their ability to reproduce. I think that the orca probably target the Chinook I mean, it's interesting, right? There could be a single Chinook that is swimming amongst a school of sockeye salmon heading, you know, in coastal waters, headed back to rivers, and they will, you know, surgically move through that that sockeye school and pick out the one Chinook if they're able to get a hold of it. So they're very specialized in that regard. And my best guess is they like Chinook for the same reason that many people do. They're large, they're fatty, they're delicious. The fact that they are, I think, large and fatty means that, you know, they're going to be able to derive more, you know, energy and resources, food from, you know, one fish. You know, it's just there's sort of a unit of food per effort. Chinook are going to be the best. And, you know, if you think historically, the Columbia Basin, you know, it was this once tremendously productive landscape that, you know, it's an area about the size of France. It has, you know, many different unique salmon and steelhead populations and subpopulations utilized in different parts of the basin. And, you know, historically, you had, for example, the June hogs. And these were fall Chinook that would come back in June to the mouth of the river. And then left to their own devices would head up all the way up the Columbia into what's now British Columbia. But these guys were sometimes 6 feet long, 100 pounds. They were monstrous Chinook and highly valued and highly delicious. And you can imagine it wouldn't take more than one or two of those guys in a given day to meet the nutritional needs of orca. Those fish are gone now. The Grand Coulee and Chief Joseph dams in the upper watershed of the Columbia Basin, for the moment, has permanently cut off that habitat, and those fish, you know, disappeared several years afterwards. So, you know, today the Chinook are still the biggest salmon swimming these marine waters. They're not as big as they used to be. And of course, they're not as abundant as they used to be, and that's obviously been a big problem.
Do you know that they were that size from historic photographs? Is that fossil record? Is it the indigenous people's stories?
Those fish were coming back even 100 years ago, so there are photographs of those. I've got photographs on my computer of, you know, fish that were basically as tall as the people that were holding them. So they, you know, in his, you know, if you want to, so that's sort of relatively recently. And of course, I think a lot of people, especially folks of European descent, have, I think, sort of environmental or sort of amnesia. It just takes a generation or two before people forget what was here, what's been lost, and what we need to be holding on to. But having said that, if you look back further, you did get much larger. There were actually, if you go back in the fossil record, in the Pacific Northwest, we're talking about hundreds of thousands of years. There were populations of saber-toothed salmon, which were even larger, and they had very large, you know, teeth. I'm sure they were, you know, predatory fish then too, but these guys were, like, you know, 10 feet long and had teeth that were inches in length. So, you know, salmon in some form have been around this landscape for a very, very long time, and orca, you know, because the fish was at one time so abundant and so large and so nutritious that, you know, it in some sense, from an evolutionary standpoint, one can imagine how, you know, some orca populations came to specialize just on those fish because they were, you know, they were around year round historically, you know, they were relatively easy to find. That's obviously, you know, changed.
Right, all because of us.
A lot of, you know, I mean, you know, orca, they've been around for at least hundreds of thousands of years, salmon too. And we're now in this place, at the, you know, beginning of the 21st century, where salmon and steelhead and orca and obviously a whole lot of other populations are teetering. So it's clear that we've made some mistakes. I think we can talk about that a bit, and it's clear that we have to figure out new ways of moving forward, new ways of living within our landscape, in order to make sure that these important species and systems and populations have a place in this landscape too. I would argue for their own sake, but also it's important for people to realize the benefits that these species bring to people as well. If you want to look at it from that sort of purely selfish perspective, the food they offer, the jobs they support, these fish, particularly salmon and steelhead, are very important culturally, economically, and ecologically in the Pacific Northwest.
So let's say I just bump into somebody outside walking their dog and tell them I was doing the podcast with you, and they're like, well, why should we save salmon? What if they either are not anglers or don't fish? What is the importance of bringing them back? I mean, for most of these listeners, we understand it, but other people that are not connected to salmon and what they are and what they do and the economics they bring in, why is it important to save these species?
Yeah. So a good question. I'll expand on my earlier comment a little bit. I'll just start with, there's a cultural reason and a justice reason. I'll start there. There's others. I think it's important first and foremost to recognize the central importance that I think for people of European descent, it's hard to appreciate how important and how central salmon were historically and are today to tribal communities in the Pacific Northwest. Many tribal people and communities consider themselves salmon people. Their relationship was sort of indistinguishable, or their presence was indistinguishable. Relationship was incredibly tight. Their worlds and livelihoods and years cycled and circled around what salmon were doing, where they were, and that sort of thing. And in ways I can't try to properly describe, and I would never sort of try to speak for tribal people, except to say that I recognize that there's this sort of fundamental role and importance that they play. That's more than economic. It's more than cultural. It's spiritual, and I think, as we were saying just a moment ago, the impact that people have had, that's been imposed on this landscape over the last 100 years, has been particularly damaging to the in integrity and health of tribal communities, and one of those impacts is sort of the severe loss of salmon. So that's one of the things. It's a justice issue. We have a responsibility here to strike a much better balance in the Columbia Basin, in the Pacific Northwest, with regards to the health of our rivers and health of our salmon and how we operate. We'll get into it, I'm sure, in a little bit, but how we operate dams and reservoirs that have really transformed this wild river system that was highly productive of fish and wildlife into one that now is almost bereft of that those resources, but produces a lot of hydroelectricity. There's a balance to be struck there. We haven't done it. And of course, those same benefits in many respects, the cultural ones, the economic ones, you know, in addition to the sort of cultural and spiritual importance of salmon to tribal people. It's a food. It's a first food that, you know, obviously nourishes their bodies. That's true of non-tribal folks too. You know, so that's an important contribution that people, I think a lot of people, whether they're from the Pacific Northwest or elsewhere, appreciate. Oh yeah, salmon is a really good food. We would, it would be a terrible loss to lose it. So there's the tribal justice issue. I'll just sort of set aside, the economics. There are tens of thousands of jobs historically, and even today, there's still many, many jobs around the Pacific Northwest and across the West Coast that exist because salmon exist. On those populations that are healthy enough to be fished on, whether it's commercial fishing or recreational fishing, and I'll take those both in turn, but I'll want to point out that there are recreational fishermen and commercial fishermen in rural communities across the West Coast, inland up into, you know, eastern Washington, central Idaho, eastern Oregon. It's a, you know, the salmon culture and landscape has been vast over time. And of course, it has shrunk. And that's something that, of course, SOS is trying to stop and reverse. We're trying to expand salmon and restore their health and productivity around their historic habitats. But, you know, they support a tremendous amount of jobs. And especially, for example, on the West Coast of Washington, you know, it's far from the, you know, technology corridor of, you know, Microsoft and Google and Seattle and Portland. You know, it's that those economies out there and communities are struggling. Historically, they relied on, you know, in the last 100 years on timber and on salmon fishing. And, you know, we have an opportunity by restoring salmon in the basin to restoring some jobs and opportunity and health and reasons to visit tourism, those coastal communities, which otherwise I think are having a really hard time making it. And as a result are, you know, as the economic opportunities decline, you often see a increase in a lot of social challenges, domestic abuse, you know, opioid or other drug abuse, poverty, poor health, early mortality, all those sorts of things. And so, you know, I think there's a really strong argument today, you know, especially if you care about what's going on in rural communities, to take steps to bring back healthy, fishable populations of salmon to help create some renewed opportunities in communities that have lost them. So that's another one. And then I want to talk a little bit about the ecological sort of quality of life slash identity. You know, the Pacific Northwest has been a salmon landscape since, you know, people first arrived here in long before. And it's one of those things that, you know, I think regardless of where you live, we all have a sense of what makes a particular area, our home city or state or region, unique. And those things have value and are worth protecting. And in the Pacific Northwest, you know, what's going to be in the top of virtually everyone's list when you ask them, is what defines the Northwest? What is the Northwest identity? It's healthy rivers, it's, you know, sprawling natural landscapes, and it's, you know, salmon ecology, culture, and economy, and food. And so I think if people can appreciate, you know, and recognize the values of their own region, they can certainly, you know, appreciate that the Pacific Northwest sort of also has this identity. And frankly, unless we do things differently, you know, that identity and that sort of signature quality of our region is at risk of disappearing.
Right. And with that environment, so in school you're taught the water cycle and the air cycle and carbon dioxide. Would you say there's a salmon cycle that defines the whole transfer of nutrients from
absolutely
it's ocean, a good question. Brings all the nutrients. You take the nutrients from the ocean that are in the fish that then die and then feed everything, and then everything takes those nutrients out, poops them, biodegrades, brings the life back, which then feeds the baby salmon, and it
right.
just goes on and on.
So let me break that down a little bit.
Absolutely.
For your listeners, salmon are this sort of fascinating creature that can move between salt water and fresh water and then back again. So the adults grow large in the ocean on the ocean ecosystem, and then they return to a relatively low nutrient freshwater ecosystem. Once they hit fresh water, they don't really eat that much, in large part because there's not much to eat. So they've adapted to sort of put on a lot of fat and be able to get upstream and go back basically to the very gravels, the very stretch of river where they themselves were born by their parents or spawned as eggs. So they have this phenomenal ability to track, and complete this amazing circle. They, salmon, will then build nests in the river, in the gravels.
There's a little crackling coming through.
Sorry. Lay eggs and then die and deliver, as you suggested, these what the scientists call marine-derived nutrients into this ecosystem that without them would often have very little nutrients in it. So if you think about, let's say in a given year, 100 years ago, we had 16 million fish returning to the Columbia-Snake River system, and a large area, admittedly. But let's say those fish on average weighed 20 pounds. You can do the math and figure out there are these bags of fertilizer that are coming from the ocean and heading into this freshwater system and delivering huge amounts of nutrients and food and energy to that system and firing up this what was and has been historically really, really rich, diverse ecosystem that supported, huge populations of bears, wolves, coyotes, eagles, and a whole lot of other critters, whether they were catching the salmon live and eating them or whether they were taking advantage of spawned out salmon that were then sort of degrading and returning to the river system. Insects, larvae, mammals, reptiles, all sorts of animals. There's one study I recall a couple of years ago documented 135 different critters that benefit from the presence of salmon and steelhead. Yeah, there's that historically, I think many forest ecologists will acknowledge the role that salmon played in building the tremendously rich historic forests, ancient forests of the Pacific Northwest by these regular annual infusions of marine-derived nutrients that year in, year out delivered all this the building blocks of trees and forest ecosystems. So that's a contribution that they've made historically that, of course, today with the steep reductions in wild populations and the replacement of some of those wild populations by hatchery fish. Well, hatchery fish are sort of a whole other topic, but one thing they don't do is sort of deliver those nutrients to the ecosystem in the same way wild fish do. So that's a really important role they've played, and again, it's one that we're struggling to return and restore.
How long has it taken? Can you see the visual effects of the nutrient flow being cut off? I mean, how has the landscape changed without millions of fish coming back?
What I'm gonna do is reverse that question.
Okay.
And ask and answer and sort of raise the issue or the question or the success story of the Elwha River on the Peninsula. Olympic Peninsula in western Washington. I bet some of your listeners are familiar with the story. The Elwha River was once a historically highly productive, prolific salmon river system. It had all five species of salmon and steelhead, and I think about a half dozen other anadromous fish species that move between saltwater and freshwater. So highly productive. About 100 years ago, two dams were constructed to produce electricity. Of course, this was done the way it was often done, without much consideration for the rule of law and without any consideration for the tribal people that lived in that area and had for thousands of years. In this case, it's the Elwha people. So these dams went in over a century ago, and this whole productive watershed shriveled up, and you got only a couple of miles of habitat available to the salmon that use this system. And so their populations, they persisted, in fact, which is a really good thing, but there was, you know, that they could be counted in sort of the dozens or hundreds in any given year, as opposed to tens of thousands. So those dams were, after a long campaign that began in the mid-70s and was led by the Elwha people in many respects, those dams were successfully removed in 2012. And since then, that watershed has been undergoing this amazing transformation and restoration. And there's been quite a bit of science conducted by various folks to understand how this system is restoring itself and how it's changing since the dams came out. So there was a whole bunch of baseline research done before the dams were removed. And then over the course of a year or so, they were removed. And, you know, one thing that's been amazing is that these fish, in many respects, without any assistance, have been, finding this habitat. It's almost like they can smell access to habitat. And so fish that haven't been seen in some cases in this system for 100 years are suddenly showing up. They're strays from other systems, but the point is that they're figuring this out. And, you know, one of the things about salmon is their incredible fecundity and resilience if you give them the sort of habitat and the rivers they need. And that's exactly what we're seeing on the Elwha, which, by the way, is the biggest river restoration dam removal project that's ever been undertaken in the United States so far. There's some bigger ones, up ahead. Coming soon, but right now the Elwha is the biggest one, and it's been a tremendous success story. And so, circling back to your original question, though having flipped it upside down, is these scientists have been doing research to understand how this system is changing, and they're looking at all kinds of different markers, like, you know, the health of the river and sediment movement and, you know, coastal estuary impacts, because, you know, one of the great things about the Elwha is these were only two dams that were on the system that was connected between the headwaters and the Olympic Mountains of the National Park. So that's great habitat, well protected, all the way down to the Puget Sound, Salish Sea, marine environment. And, I'll just start with the restoration of the fish themselves. These fish have come back way faster than any of the scientists ever predicted. There's still a long ways to go, But these fish are moving up through the system that they haven't had access to for 100 years. And they, you know, again, you give them the river, they know exactly what to do with it. So you've got Chinook coming back. You've got sockeye coming back. You've got steelhead coming back. And with it, you know, they're laying eggs, they're spawning out, they're dying. So what some scientists have been doing is looking at what's going on terrestrially with other fish and wildlife populations to see what kind of effect they've had. Well, some of the early results have shown, for example, that otter are coming back into the system in higher numbers than they had previously been, and that their clutch sizes, the number of young they have when they give birth, is going up. And they're able to actually track and recognize marine-derived nutrients in the fat and blood of these otters. They can sort of collect some of this information without harming the otter. But what they're noticing is A, increased productivity, and B, they're actually seeing the marine nutrients in this population. So that's a really positive result. The other thing that the other specific study that I can think of, which is the American Dipper, which is a bird that lives in and along water systems West.
Yeah, caught a couple by accident.
Oh, is that right? Yeah.
Yeah.
So a scientist was doing research on the response of dippers. Well, dippers, for example, will take advantage of, where they see a nest, a salmon or steelhead nest, that they might eat a few of the eggs. So this nutrients that's coming out of the ocean and being deposited into the elwha is feeding these dippers, and the dippers are having also a sort of interesting biological response. One is they're having, instead of just one clutch in the elwha basin in a clutch of eggs in the sort of spring summer season, they're now having two clutches, and the survival of each of those clutches is going up. And so the dipper population is on the increase, and again, also here they've done some blood draws. And they've detected nitrogen and other nutrients that have come from the ocean. There's markers that make it easy to detect, and so they're getting these nutrients, and it's obvious that they're sort of benefiting from them as well. So the sort of flip of your question is, where we've restored salmon and we've restored river access and habitat, what's the response been? Well, it's been really, really good by the whole overall ecological system.
And not that long of a time either.
Very short period of time. Yeah. So that's super exciting. And the fact is, I think that one of the things that, change is always hard. It took a long time to secure the public support and political will to remove these dams, restore this river. But the fact is, especially in this era, where there's a lot of bad news coming at us from sort of different angles, the notion that we can, right some wrongs, fix some of our mistakes, restore rivers and salmon and populations and systems. It's not just salmon that we're restoring. We're really restoring a system. And, I think that as 20 years ago, dam removal was sort of, marginalized as some sort of radical dream of environmentalists who wanted us to live in caves, and of course it wasn't true then and it's not true now, but what is true is that much more of the public has come to recognize both the value of restoring these systems, the opportunity, the economic and ecological and cultural benefits, the benefits to often rural communities where these river systems exist, and that's super encouraging, because I think when you stop and think about it, some people argue, well, geez, these dams are they're like the pyramids. We've built them, and they should never come down. But of course, in another perspective, they're utilitarian tools, and they have a lifetime, just like a car or a fridge or just about any other piece of equipment that we purchase or make or use. And the balance can also shift as to their costs and benefits. And in an era today where we have a heck of a lot more energy sources, especially alternative energy sources that aren't producing carbon, and they have effectively a much smaller footprint on the landscape and also support jobs. You know, there's a lot of alternatives. So we have opportunities here to maintain and continue to expand our energy, our clean energy supply, while we're also looking around and figuring out, okay, the ledger on some dams, not all today anyways, but the ledger on some dams is gotten to the point where, you know, their costs exceed their benefits. And when that occurs, it's time to make a change. And that's what happened on the Elwha. The numbers in many ways, well, they didn't drive that decision, but they were essential to the overall equation. And I think, you know, we've got 75,000 dams in this country. You can bet that some of them were based on or you know, either the economics have changed over time or they were, you know, sort of built on a faulty premise in the beginning. You know, we're now in a position, I think, where people are sort of, you know, scratching their head and saying, we've got this new public policy tool. We can restore rivers. We can generate greater benefits to society by restoring it, by removing these dams, restoring these rivers, and investing in, you know, clean, less impactful alternative sources of energy.
What is the largest dam removal project you are currently involved with?
So,
Snake?
Yeah, the Sierra Wild Salmon for its 25 years has largely been focused on addressing the harmful impacts of the overzealous dam building era of the last century. And when we started in the early 90s in response to the Endangered Species Act listings of Snake River sockeye, our focus was on making operational changes to the ways the dams and the reservoirs were run in order to create some additional space for salmon and allow the populations to survive and maybe recover a bit. And over time through the 90s, the science just became irrefutable that, you know, we had sort of gone overboard on dam construction to a point where there was very little space left for these fish, and that in some instances removal was going to be necessary, or we were going to have to say goodbye to these, you know, powerful, influential, historic fish populations, and all the benefits that we've been talking about that they deliver to people and fish and wildlife and ecosystems. And some of the worst offenders in the Columbia Basin are the four dams on the Lower Snake River in southwest Washington State. The Snake River is the main tributary of the Columbia River, which originates in British Columbia, flows south through central Washington, and then takes a sharp turn to the west and you know, flows into the Pacific Ocean. The Snake originates in Yellowstone National Park in Wyoming. That's where its headwaters are. And it flows, it meanders a little bit west and north, and eventually into southeast Washington, and then flows into the Columbia in south central Washington State. If that gives you a sort of impression of where the Snake River was once the most productive, even though it had a relatively small geography in the overall Columbia Basin, it was one of the most productive landscapes for salmon for whatever reason. I don't really understand why. I don't know if scientists do, but it was highly productive. It produced like half of the spring Chinook or more if the entire Columbia Basin was found upstream in the Snake River Basin. And the four lower Snake River dams, they were built in the 60s and 70s. That was sort of the getting towards the end of the dam building era. And, you know, the various folks had sort of suggested and pushed for construction of these dams for decades before, but the Army Corps had always resisted it because they, by their own admission in the middle of last century, acknowledged that they didn't pencil out. There wasn't enough head there for electrical production. We had a ton of electricity in the region already anyways. They were going to cost a lot to build and maintain, and their benefits were going to be very modest.
They're obsolete once they were built.
Even before they were built, right. So what happened, though, of course, and often does happen, is, you know, Congress got the best of the Corps, and you know, the other dam sites had been built out, and the Corps at some point probably sort of said to themselves, well, geez, you know, if we want to build a dam, I guess we should build them here. So they did a bunch of funny paperwork to make it appear as if they would pencil out. And then they got the okay from Congress or the approval from Congress. I mean, Congress, frankly, was pushing them to build these. And they went ahead and did it. And immediately afterwards, in the mid-1970s, when the four dams were completed, the salmon populations in the Snake River, as predicted, as we knew would occur, plummeted, and they've never recovered.
Completely crashed.
Yep, 90% loss. And we lost the Snake River coho in the mid-80s. And then there's a number of other populations that are holding on. Sockeye, Snake River sockeye, who find their homes in the Rocky Mountains. So they connect the Rocky Mountains up at 7,000 feet to the Pacific Ocean.
It's a massive drainage.
Exactly. And you know, I mean, the amazing thing about sockeye and also other salmon of central Idaho, these are among the longest migrating salmon on the planet. They're not the longest, but they're among the longest. They have a migration that takes 900 miles upstream to get back to their spawning grounds, but they are by a long shot the highest migrating. These fish climb almost 7,000 feet in elevation to get back to their spawning grounds to spawn out and die. It's an astonishing elevation that they climb. And it's fantastic habitat, and it's highly prolific, and they figured it out, and they've been doing it for thousands and thousands and thousands of years until we come along and impose a whole bunch of these dams and reservoirs, and they've been, you know, struggling to really exist ever since.
It's amazing how fast we can screw something up in so little time.
It is. I mean, our perspectives are I think, you know, again, as sort of Westerners in North America, our perspectives are very, very short, especially when you think about the perspectives of the original inhabitants of this area, who think in much, much longer time frames. And, you know, in 100 years, we've brought this system and its benefits to its knees. And, you know, the exciting thing is, of course, is that there is, you know, when it comes to restoring rivers in the Pacific Northwest, we have been an epicenter of river restoration and dam removal. It's been hard, but it's getting easier because, as with each project, people realize, local communities, regionally, oh, we can make this transition. This actually can be better than what it was if we do it right. And it's not that all dams are bad and all dams are going to be removed. I do think it's true that all dams have a footprint and an impact. But you have to sort of look at the larger context and what the alternatives are and what their costs and benefits are over time. I mean, one of the things that I do think is something that the Pacific Northwest is beginning to grapple with in this century and will continue to, is the recognition that this big centralized energy production system that was built in the last century it's getting older. It's aging, and its cost, you know, its initial cost post construction were relatively low. Everything was new. You know, things ran for the most part pretty well. But now they're, you know, these things are 50, 60, 70, 80 years old. which is in many cases beyond the predicted lifetime of these dams. And I think that, you know, it's a difficult conversation for folks in the region, particularly if they've been sort of invested in participants in the construction of the system in the last century, because, you know, change is the thing that's ever present. And I think that we've got a lot of change ahead. And it's, you know, as we were saying earlier, the energy sector, technologies, costs, economies, is changing so fast today, there are a heck of a lot of additional options that are at lower cost. And there's a transition that we're in the midst of, and it's only going to continue to accelerate. And I think it's very hard to imagine that, you know, the dams are going to escape that transition, because simple fact is that, you know, they're these big centralized built structures that over time are going to just, their costs are going to make maintenance and continued operations very, very challenging. Today, for example, the solar in Washington, in California, the investment in solar, because prices have really come down in the last 5 years, has just been way beyond what expectations were. And returning to the Snake River dams, in the, you know, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, the energy produced by the Snake River dams was often sent down to California to be used there. As a clean energy resource, it was sold on the open market, and it was a good source of revenue for Bonneville Power Administration that markets the power from the hydro system, the federal hydro system in the Columbia Basin. Today, however, California has an energy surplus in the spring, the very time when these Snake River dams produced the vast majority of their energy, because they don't store water. They produce when the river's flowing. That's of course in the springtime when the big snow melts happen. Mm-hmm. So the market for Snake River energy, it still exists, but it's greatly diminished because competition and pushing from other sources of energy that are coming online. And I think that kind of pressure and those kinds of changes are only going to further undermine the argument for keeping these highly costly dams that are getting older, that we're spending literally hundreds of millions of dollars every year to try to mitigate their harmful salmon impacts. And that's a big piece of the equation here on why I think it's just a matter of time before the Lower Snake River dams, a decision is made that it's time to remove the Lower Snake River dams and restore that river. Is it's economics. It's simple economics. It's a basic cost benefit analysis of, you know, the alternatives are available. They're less costly and less impactful. And the, you know, over time, the Lower Snake River dams costs are rising. They were built for two basic reasons. Actually, they were originally conceived of for one reason, and that was what was going to be heavily subsidized commercial navigation, flat water reservoirs for barges to ship product down to the city of Portland, Port of Portland, for export. They had to add in the electrical production in order to get the dams closer to penciling out, although it was still a struggle, and in a time when there was a huge surplus of energy in the region, so there wasn't really a market for it then. There has been a market, you know, to be fair, for that energy during the last, several decades. But again, as I just said, that market is changing so dramatically. Much bigger regional and global forces and technological forces are I think, leading taking us to a place where the Lower Snake River dams are, they're not quite obsolete, but damn near. And today they cost more. The cost of operations and mitigation for salmon impacts is greater than the benefits they deliver to the region. And so when the numbers look that way, it becomes just a matter of time before decisions get made and changes are made.
Do you have a special bottle of scotch or champagne you've been holding on to for the day the dams come down?
I do have a couple of bottles of beer. I'm not sure how well they'll hold up over time. Demolition is in the title, and I set those aside about 15 years ago for opening and the time when the river is restored. And as I said, it's been a long battle so far. We've been at this for over 15 years, but the Elwha was no different. And these battles are getting shorter. I should spend a little bit of time, Rob, talking about, I think, what the next big river restoration in the Northwest is going to be, and that's on the Klamath River in Southern Oregon, Northern California. And that is a river system, very similar sets of issues on the Elwha in terms of, energy production, harmful tribal impacts, harmful impacts on salmon and populations. It's been a battle with agricultural communities too, which is not part of the Elwha narrative, but it is part of the in some ways part of the Snake River landscape too. But there's been a 20-year battle waged over the future of these four privately owned dams on the Klamath River, which have had terrible effects on salmon and as a result commercial fisheries and native communities. Well, in 2020, a deal has been brokered where the Pacific Corps, the owner of those dams, has recognized that the value of those dams is less than their costs, and it's a good, smart business decision to remove them. And that's what they're going to do. And that's going to start in 2020. It should last, I think, as I understand it, it should all occur sort of within a 12 or 18 month period. So it's going to be very rapid. And it's going to restore one of the, on the West Coast, one of our, top five, top six salmon rivers on the West Coast. So it's a huge opportunity. It's been a long haul. People came together and figure out a way to make it work so that the people that have relied on that system of dams and reservoirs are being transitioned, they're being bought out, there are alternatives being created to make sure, for example, there are clean energy resources available to them. That's an important piece of this equation is we've got to make some transitions, right? We've got to make some changes. Things aren't working anymore. But it's also important to recognize that, there are constituencies and communities and businesses that have come to rely on the current circumstances. And it's, I think, incumbent on us and the responsible thing to do to make sure that we put together a package or a plan with the various stakeholders to make that transition and not create new problems, but address some old ones and make sure that we've got a better system, a more sustainable system that's gonna work as we move forward. And they did that in the Klamath, they did it in the Elwha, and that's the kind of work we're really prioritizing and encouraging in terms of conversations with key stakeholders on the lower Snake as well.
Well, I thank you for fighting the good fight for all of us.
Well,
it seems like you've got your hands full.
It's a fascinating and inspiring controversy, challenge, battle, whatever you want to call it. It gets me out of bed every morning. Salmon are sort of amazing and I find inspiring critters for various reasons. They're indicators of healthy ecosystems. If we're doing right by salmon, we're probably doing right by the landscape and the rivers. Salmon are also connectors. They connect, freshwater with saltwater. They connect tribal people with non-tribal people. They connect, eaters of food, with the folks who you know fish for that food. They connect urban and rural. It's no accident that they are viewed by many as sort of in some ways the heart and soul of the Pacific Northwest and its landscape. And so to me, it's an easy battle in some respects to get up and engage in every day, because the benefits, not just to salmon, but to communities, even I think to some of those communities that are resistant to making the kinds of changes we need to make sure they're here. There's opportunities that I think many people will come to see as like, oh, geez, this, it's the Elwha has been an amazing success story. You can point to a lot of other dam removal projects where they've just been success stories. The restoration of fish, the restoration of the river have happened much more quickly than people anticipated. And I think that, this is a tremendous opportunity. Restoring the Lower Snake River is going to be, it's sort of unprecedented. It's going to be the biggest salmon and river restoration project this nation's ever undertaken. We've got a little more work to do, but it's very exciting because we're approaching that tipping point and I'm looking forward to sort of entering that new phase of figuring out the details of how to get it done.
How can we help you and the listeners when you get up in the morning to fight the good fight? How can we all help?
There's a number of ways that folks can help. First of all, just getting educated and informed about what's going on. I encourage you to visit wildsalmon.org. www.wildsalmon.org. That's our website. We've also got a number of social media accounts or handles. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and that's another way of sort of tracking what we're doing and getting informed.
Tell you how you just click on it, fill something out, and it sends a letter to your congressmen, representatives.
Sure, we've got alerts on our website. There's also a way to sign up to make sure you get into our database, and you'll hear from us periodically with updates on campaign progress and different activities. So getting educated and as a first step, and then sharing that information, encouraging other people to learn, to be active, to be, of course, contacting elected officials. That's obviously a key pivot point, right? We've got to move the politics. I think in the Pacific Northwest, it's an issue about politics. The economics are becoming increasingly clear. The science is increasingly clear. We know what we need to do to sort of fix things. We've got to continue to move the politics, and that means, the politicians and key constituencies and agencies to come together and work on a solution that works for all of us. Engagement politically is always a critical tool that still works in this system despite the rather dire political landscape I find myself in on a frequent basis these days. I think that's going to change. I look forward to that. But the other thing is, there's opportunities to donate and support our organization with your financial contributions. As I said at the beginning of the show, Rob, we're a fairly lean 501c3 nonprofit organization, and we depend on the support of donors, large and small, to help us continue to advance and progress towards some of our big project goals. Those are some key ways. And of course, my email and cell phone's available on the website. And if you're listening and you want more information, I don't hesitate to just reach out directly. I'd look forward to exchanging emails or getting on the phone and chatting further.
My last question is, I'm assuming you've got a massive library in your office of books. Is there a book you would suggest for myself or others just to read more about the history of salmon and just kind of break down everything we've talked about today?
I could name a couple of books.
I got my pencil.
Yep. So one is a book by Dr. David Montgomery called called King of Fish. And that gives a really good overview that starts back in Europe, where there used to be healthy, robust salmon runs that were highly regarded. And there was protective laws around how we treated rivers and how we impacted those runs. They were ineffective over time, and those populations were lost. And then that process hit the East Coast. We had Atlantic salmon on the eastern seaboard of the United of North America, and those populations have been hammered. And now we're in the Pacific Northwest, where we have the most robust populations remaining outside of Alaska. But we're still facing the same kinds of challenges. He does a great job of providing that historical perspective. Okay. And that's a broad survey. The other one I would suggest, I think is great, and it really focuses in on the Lower Snake River. It's called River of Life, Channel of Death. And it was written by a gentleman named Keith Peterson. And it really focuses in on many of the issues that we've touched on here lightly today, about the fecundity of that river system before the dams were installed, and then the sort of really poor economics, decision making and sleight of hand that occurred to get those dams constructed, and then of course we know the legacy we're living with today. Finally, I would point people towards our we have on our website a sort of video library. And there's a number of short videos. Some are, 5, 6, 7 minutes long. There's a 30-minute video that was produced back in 1970. It's a great piece of historic documentary called Struggle for the Snake. And that takes a hard look at the economic controversies back in 1970 and the battle over whether we should be building these dams at all. And it's a classic, 1970s documentary that I found just – I only was made aware of it in last year, and it's just it's a must-see.
Well, I'm going to check out all of those. Any last things you wanted to talk about before we get you back to saving our salmon?
I don't think so, Rob.
We can always do it again.
Yeah, no, I appreciate the opportunity to chat with you and your listeners' interest, and let's stay in touch.
Fantastic, Joseph. Thank you so much for this.
It's my pleasure.
All right. Take care. Take care. Cheers. Bye bye.
Thank you for joining us for the Fly Fishing Consultant Podcast. For more information or to contact Rob, please go to www.robsnowwhite.com.